I absolutely love this time of the year. It's a time definitely where people congregate around the kitchen, and not just for sweets either. I've come up with a sensible cocktail, a gin and ginger, which avoids all of that sweetness this time of the year is associated with. It's Campari gin and alcoholic ginger beer, garnished with orange, and let me tell you, it's absolutely fantastic. And to accompany my original cocktail is roasted poussin with sweet potato and butternut squash mash, with an accompaniment of a puttanesca sauce, which adds heat and tangy pungency to the whole dish. I allow one bird per person, and it's all about my theory that whole food means we eat things slower, and we actually take the time to talk to people, we actually take the time to socialise, rather than 5-minute meals where we just eat, 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 and then it's gone. We actually spend time communicating, and when we spend time communicating, it's absolutely more social. Cooking is social, that's what it's all about. There's absolutely no point putting in the effort cooking a meal if we're just going to eat it in 5 minutes flat. And so I hope you enjoy watching me prepare this dish, and thanks for watching. When I wanted to create my own aperitif this season, I thought, well, it's got to be delicious, it's got to be alcoholic, this aperitif. It's got to be different, it's got to be original. Lots of cocktails this season tend to be too sweet. And believe you and me, I've got enough dessert, I've got enough sweets and chocolate to last me a lifetime during this season. I do not want my drinks to be too sweet. So I thought, well, why don't I create a cocktail which is cosmopolitan, it's different, it's sort of 007 of cocktails. So what I have here is a segment of a Yafra orange from Israel. And what you need to do is ring the glass with the orange, there we go. And then squeeze some of the juice into the glass and drop. I think I'll represent London now with a double shot of Tanqueray. I recommend using London Dry Gin for this cocktail. Bombay Sapphire has too much going on. It's fine in a gin tonic, but there's just too much going on which will interfere with flavours here, which I want to be bold but simple. And various other gins are not so good either. For instance, Plymouth is somewhat too dry. So you want to have Tanqueray or above. William's Chase is also a very good gin, but you might want to just save that for your gin and tonics with Fever Tree tonic. Now we have our gin, and now we're going to represent Scotland with Krabby's alcoholic ginger beer, which puts the ginger in my gin and ginger aperitif. That bubbling up of a bit of fizz. And to finish it off, we'll represent Italy, and I've got a lovely Venetian portrait on the bottle, a bottle of Campari, and you can free pour this. It's only going to be a dash, and just watch the colour change. I think this is a bit of a Halloween treat. Look, it almost looks like blood in a syringe. But maybe you don't have my imagination. As you'll notice, it'll turn this glorious scarlet colour. And since I think this gin is so delicious, I do think it's a Pimm's killer. So I think I'll be ironic and use a Pimm's stirrer just to mix it up a bit. So we've got some gin with its flavour of juniper. We've got Campari with its bitterness. Ginger beer, which adds some heat and just a little bit of sweetness, but not too much. And some orange, which rounds off this drink. And that's for taste. If you can find a better seasonal drink than my gin and ginger, please you have to share it with me or make millions by selling it, because I don't think you can get much better than this. What attracts me about the idea of Poussin is that you can have one per person, because generally I eat with very hungry people. And because of the bones, and this isn't in a bad way where it's really bony and you've got to chew and pick, you can take your time with food. These days there isn't enough emphasis placed on actually sitting with someone and enjoying your food. With a Poussin, you actually carve your own bird at the table. And it does take time, but every moment is worth it. With these birds, they've had 10 minutes in the oven already. I've laid two of them on a bed of celery, onion and carrot, herbe aromatique, a French essential for any poultry you roast. I've put a bit of salt on top, and I've stuffed them with Amalfi lemons from Italy. So maximum flavour, I'm really getting the lemon already, even after just 10 minutes. The only problem with Poussin is the breast cooks faster than the leg, and so to cook it evenly is generally impossible unless you spatchcock it. But as I say, I like the idea of being presented with a whole bird. So it's had 10 minutes in the oven and it's cooling as we speak. So what I've proposed is, it's got a little bit of colour. What I've proposed to keep that breast moist is to use some sliced pancetta wrapped across like a little blanket for each Poussin. This is the reason why I've not added butter to this recipe, because pancetta is a rather fatty cut of meat, full of flavour, but fatty. But it doesn't have to be bad, it just means you don't have to add any further fat. Look at that, just for this one Poussin, there's a blanket, a protective blanket. So as this pancetta cooks, fat seeps into the breast and works with the lemon in the cavity to keep that breast moist whilst those legs cook. Fantastic. And even though I don't generally eat the herbe aromatique, it's just there for flavour, so the oven cavity is steamed with this vegetable sweetness which transfers to the poultry. But we will have this pancetta simply because we can snip it up when it's nice and crispy into our salad. So how is that? A nice blanket. So they've had 10 minutes already, so I recommend we use about 25 to 30 minutes. Make sure the juices run clear and then let the Poussin rest wrapped tightly in foil for a further 15 minutes. And whilst the Poussin is roasting, we can get on with our Poussinesca sauce. In the spirit of the season, I really need to corrupt these Poussin, and I've come up with just the perfect accompanying sauce. It's called Poussinesca in Italian, and so this must be my Poussin alla Poussinesca. French and Italian, I do apologise for the language confusion. But it means very much so Poussin in a Moorish fashion. And what I have here is some caramelised shallots and some garlic sizzling in a pan. Not nothing too controversial, but now I'm really going to add some heat. I have here some chopped up anchovies, olives and capers. I'm just going to add them all in. Nice, I love that sound. Already you get that sort of saltiness from the anchovies. Do not salt this dish. Even though I've given the olives and capers a little bit of a wash because of their brine preservative, it's ever so important You do not salt this. All of these ingredients have been salted already. About half a tin of tomatoes. Calm things down a bit. Add a bit of piquancy. Let this bubble just for a minute. And check your piece on in the oven whilst you're at it. Fabulous. I mean, I know I add vermouth as an optional ingredient in my recipe for my poussin, but as you open that oven, the herb aromatique, the vermouth and the lemon really do scent the house. They really do. It sounds dramatic, but they do scent the house. As soon as you walk into this house, it feels homely. Sauce burning. This should be on the highest heat, really. You don't want to waste time. You want it to be quite thick. So just give it 1 minute. It gives feedback via steam, so you can really tell how well it's doing. And it's called puttanesca. I mean, a slattern's poussin, it means like a corrupt poussin. People of little means, especially women in France, used to rely on stored ingredients. You've got capers, you've got olives, anchovies, all stored in the cupboard. And it means you're either very lazy or you don't have time to get fresh ingredients. And such was the lifestyle of some ladies of the night. But show some respect for these poussins and use the highest quality ingredients you can, such as this masala, which will transform the sauce from a sort of aggressive salty tomatoey sauce to one which is smoky and has a rounded flavour. It's really just fortified wine from Sicily. Almost immediately, it's almost as if I set this on fire and you can, all of those aggressive flames from earlier are now just a smoky echo. Still spicy on the kick, but less in your face, because the poussin on its own is tasty enough, you do not want to drown it out. But just a little help here. Some dried chili flakes, about a half a tablespoon, more if you're feeling adventurous. So clamp a lid on that, cook from a low to medium heat for about 20 minutes, you've got the perfect puttanesca sauce on the side. Whilst the poussin has been resting, I've boiled some mashed potato, sweet potato with butternut and squash in equal measure. I just added some butter to the mixture. Any good mashed potato has butter. Sort of a smooth, velvety texture to assist on that count. I've got some cream, just a good dash of cream. You'll lighten the mash, you'll look less severe. And whilst I've been cooking, I've had this wonderful idea to present my mashed potato in a pumpkin. So it can't be too orange or look too different. There we go, that's just the orange I want, just slightly lighter. I've got pepper. And you should have by now tasted your puttanesca sauce. If it's far too salty, do not add any more salt to your mash, because the lack of salt in the poussin on the mash will balance the salty heat of the puttanesca. And see, it's more of a puree rather than a mash. It slides off the masher rather easily. So counteract this, we should put it on the heat for roughly 10 minutes on a low to medium heat, 10 minutes maximum. Just sort of air it out a bit. Then and the poo sun is resting, so all what's left to do in 10 minutes time is plate up. Now what I've got here is the potato heating through. I've added some chopped ginger, which will respond to the heat and always dissolve into the sauce and impart its zestiness. Add a bit of pecorino, which is like a blue cheese version of parmesan. It's not strictly a blue cheese, but since it's from sheep's milk, I find it has that tanginess, which this mash wants, with the ginger, which is quite a good combination. Just a dash more cream to taste. And even as you cook it, you can tell it's going to be a velvety mash. And despite the cheese and the cream, two of your five a day as well, so feel virtuous. And it's very easy to feel zen when ginger is in a dish. So whilst this heats through, get your serving dish out and pop on a bed of leaves and the chicken, and then we'll present the potato and the sauce, and you'll have a fabulous holiday meal for this season. Now what we have here is the pumpkin, which is topped with parmesan and toasted breadcrumbs. Also add some of the pumpkin seeds on top for a bit of extra crunch. We have the poussin. I've discarded the most fatty bits of pancetta and left the meatier bits just to add some decoration. I've sprinkled some tarragon all over to add a sort of aniseedy, liquishy sort of dimension to complement the flavours. And the puttanesca sauce, as you can see, that rapid cooking quickly thickens the sauce, and so you can, it's so easy to manage. It's not liquidy and it doesn't mix with the potato whatsoever involuntarily. You get some oily sauces, which you don't want. That's a perfect sauce which will complement the poussin wonderfully. Well, I'm Kyle Allen, and bon appétit!